hallelujah. Our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Our God is the Lamb, the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Coming to God as your Savior, let me hear you give Him a praise and a shout and a clap this morning. Praise His name. He's our Lion and He's our Lamb. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. How many of you know that we serve a God that's faithful? How many of you know that we serve a God that's faithful? Yes, He is. He'll continue to do what He's done in our past. I've said this before, but this is coming to me again, that there's a reason why God told the 12 tribes of Israel to lay those stones. It's for one specific reason, for them to remember what God had done for them in the past, that He continued to deliver them from the hands of evil. So I ask you today, there are times where it may seem like God isn't answering, that He's not there, that He's quiet, that it's a lull. But I ask you to do one thing. Just remember the times when He's been there for you in the past. Because if you did then, He will now, and He will continue to. That's God's promise. That's God's promise. We thank you, Jesus, that you are steadfast, that you're unmovable, God, that everything, Father, comes to you. Thank you. I sing that one more time. Get in your spirit and sing.
It's that simple.
He's faithful. That's easy.
He's faithful.
So I don't know where we may be this morning. I don't know what challenges we may be facing. Maybe we have a sickness. Maybe we have a hurt or pain. Maybe we have a financial need. Maybe we just need some direction. Whatever it is, whatever our need may be, he's
faithful.
And we've been singing all morning about how we know he's been faithful, how we know he's going to continue to be faithful. So wherever you are right now, in the middle of struggle, in the middle of your pain, just remember that he is faithful. God, we thank you that you remain faithful. We thank you.
Thank you.
Maybe there's one here this morning, you say, you know what, you guys talk about he's been faithful, he's always there and doing all these things, but I really don't know about that. I don't have a relationship, I don't know much about this God you guys are saying is so faithful, this God that you're saying is there for us all the time, I don't know about him, I don't know him. You can get to know him this morning. Because no matter what kind of life you lived up to this point, no matter how far you feel like you are from God, no matter how bad you think you've been, he's faithful. And then all we have to do is call on him. All we have to do is call on him and say, God, I need you and I need you to forgive me. All we have to do is say, God, I believe in you. So right now, with every head bowed and every eye closed, if you're in this place, you say, you know what, I don't have that relationship, and I want to get that relationship. I want to know this faithful God that you guys are singing about. If that's you just right now, no one looking around except for the prayer team, just lift your hand. Say, I want to know. I want to know this God that is faithful. God, we thank you. God, we thank you that you are so faithful that you came and you washed us clean and you forgave us and you loved us when we were living lives that did not deserve it. And God, right now we lift up our movers. These are 10 people that we know are not living for you, that we know need to meet you and need to experience your faithfulness, need to experience your everlasting love. And God, we pray that right now that you are positioning people in their lives to represent you and to represent your love and to be your love and to speak life and speak truth into them. To where they can come to meet you. To where they can come to know this faithful God who always was, who always will be faithful. God, we thank you for it. God, we thank you for this morning. We pray that you continue to move throughout this service. And Lord, help us learn your truth and learn the things that you have for us. In Jesus' name. Come on, if you guys believe that, say amen. Amen, amen. We'll turn to three people and welcome them to Passion this morning. You guys can grab a seat.
All right, so there are some things that are complex and complicated, right? For instance, how many of you discovered that the text code is complicated and complex, right? I mean, it's like trying to read Greek. By the way, Greek is complicated. Okay, that's a different subject. Here's another one that's kind of complex and complicated, at least to me. The scoring in boxing. Have you ever watched the Olympics and you know somebody won and then all of a sudden they change who won and you go, this makes no sense at all. It's just like complex and complicated. Relationships. So relationships are kind of complicated at times, right? They become difficult. Have you ever been in a difficult relationship?
Nobody?
So like, nobody's going to admit that, like, okay, so not even, okay, I've got some honest folks. They're doing it behind you so that you don't know, because some of them are talking about you right now. So here's one that's complex and complicated to me. The fascination with pumpkin spice.
I just don't understand.
I don't get it.
It makes no sense at all. So it's complicated. All right, those are some complicated things.
But how many of you know that faith was never supposed to be complicated? Right? Now, when man gets in the mix with faith, we kind of make it very, very difficult. But Jesus arrives on the scene. He begins to walk this planet. And from the day he begins his ministry until the very end, he systematically tries to make faith more simple. He tries to clarify and simplify it for us so that we understand. And we talked about this. And so one of the things that we talked about is that one of the simple aspects of faith that Jesus calls us to is this: discipleship. He wants us to be disciples. So we begin to try to define, what do disciples do? Well, we said, number one, they obey, that disciples obey. So what do we obey? We said last week that disciples are fully devoted followers of Christ. That's a great definition of a disciple, yet nobody ever really stops and says, well, what are they devoted to? Because if you don't know what they're devoted to, then you're never going to be as obedient as we should be. So we began to look at this passage of Scripture last week. It's Acts chapter 2. It begins in verse 42, and this is what it says. It says, they devoted, there's that word again, they devoted it. I'm so glad that Scripture tells us what they devoted themselves to, right? He didn't leave us guessing. He tells us they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. So we began to look at this and we said very simply, disciples study. If you're going to be a disciple of Christ, one of the elements of that is you've got to study Scripture. You've got to know the Word. You will never know the Word if you don't spend any time in the Word, right? You won't know that He's talking to you if you don't listen to Him in His Word. So last week we said they were devoted to His Word. Well, I know the next logical progression in this is this. They were devoted to fellowship. But I'm not even going to spend any time on that. I'm just going to skip right over it. You know why? Because I've talked to you at least 50 times over the last 11 years about our need for one another. I do want to mention to you, though, if you go back and read slowly this passage of Scripture, what you discover is this. Fellowship is mentioned more than any other thing that they did. In fact, it's mentioned 3 separate times. Word. Right? It's repeated because it's important. All right, so that's all I'm saying about that. I'm moving on. So because we've talked about that over and over again, that we need one another. So another thing that the disciples were devoted to is what we're going to spend our time on today. The record indicates this. Disciples pray. They devoted themselves to prayer. Now, let me stop right here and do this little disclaimer because I know how this works. Anytime I've ever been in a service where a preacher begins to teach or preach about prayer, I start getting nervous. I think we all do. I think the reason that we do is that most of us feel very inadequate in this particular area of our walk with Christ, our prayer life. And so when a preacher begins to talk about preaching and they outline this standard by which we judge whether we have a great prayer life or not, we all want to duck our heads and then what we do is we do what Steve does. We go home, and then we make another run at it, right? Out of guilt and shame, we try to live up to this this particular way of praying and this guide for praying that they outline, the defined prayer warrior. That's what we want to be, how they define being a prayer warrior. And we spend our time, sometimes out of guilt, trying to live up to a standard that we ultimately discover is very difficult to live up to. In my day, this show you how old I was, it was, could you not tarry 1 hour? If you weren't praying 1 hour, buddy, you weren't a disciple, right? And I struck out. Okay, so here we go. If we make things complex when it comes to prayer, this is what we do. We tend to gravitate towards eloquent prayer. Thus, O Lord, the shining star of the everlasting ethereal sphere we call. All right, we want to get off. All right. We gravitate to this eloquent prayer. But James chapter 5, verse 16 says this: the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. It does not say that effective prayer is eloquent prayer. The effectual, eloquent prayers of righteous men, it doesn't say that, right? It says the effectual, fervent prayer of righteous men availeth much. What it's saying is there is a way to pray that is effective. So I want us to have effective prayer. I don't care if you don't know how to pray eloquently and you feel embarrassed when you pray. It doesn't really matter. As long as your prayers are effective. I want effective prayers, not eloquent prayers. I want effective prayers that bring change. I want effective prayer that causes atmospheres to transform. I want effective prayers to bring healing. I want effective prayers to bring deliverance. I want effective prayers that bring salvation. So how do we get to be effective in our prayer life? Well, I want us to look at two types of prayer that I believe that Jesus and his disciples modeled for us that were effective prayers, right? The first one is this. I believe that if we become effective in prayer, if we get this, disciples pray consistently. That produces effective prayers. When disciples pray consistently, let me prove it to you. Luke chapter 5, verse 16 says this, but Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. Did you catch the key word? Often. How many times? Often. How frequent was his prayer life? Often. He often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. So one of the reasons that the disciples, I believe, devoted themselves to a consistent prayer life is this. Their rabbi modeled consistency in his prayer life. That's why the disciples learned to pray consistently, was because their rabbi modeled consistent prayer for them. I'm not even going to preach this, but parents. Okay, I wanted to see if you could make application without my help. There you go. So that's why I believe that Paul comes along later and he begins to address our prayer life. And he says this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17. It's the one we always quote. Here it is. Pray without ceasing. Has that verse of scripture ever bothered anybody else? So it has me, because pray without ceasing, but it's only because we don't understand what he's saying. Because in the Greek, the words without ceasing doesn't mean pray nonstop. Is there anybody in here that is so free in their schedule that they can pray nonstop? I mean, the kids never cry. The dog never needs to go out. The cat never ignores you. You don't have to work. You don't have any family relationships to address or deal with. You're just so free in life that you can absolutely pray without ever stopping. Is it? Okay, I thought maybe I was in the right crowd. What it actually means is this. This is what the translation means. Consistently reoccurring. That's what it means to pray without ceasing. That there's this consistent reoccurrence of prayers over and over. So Paul would come back again then in Colossians chapter 4, verse 2, and he would make this statement to us. He actually gives us a command. He says, devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. Simply put, to be a disciple, we must have a consistent, ongoing, reoccurring, personal conversation with Jesus. That's as simple as you can put it. There should be this consistent, reoccurring, personal conversation with Jesus. Why? because your level of communication will determine the level of your connectedness. If you're not communicating with him, you will not stay connected to him. Other voices will get into the mix. Other things will get into the mix. So there has to be this development of a consistent, ongoing, frequently reoccurring conversation with the one that we say is our rabbi. See, we used to judge whether someone was praying by whether they attended prayer meetings. And if you're old enough to remember that, it was like you got prizes almost. I mean, we didn't actually give you one, but the esteem for you went up higher if you were the ones that would come to a prayer meeting. If anybody would come to a prayer meeting, they must be spiritual giants. I want to fix that a little bit this morning and tell you that I am convinced that the real indication of whether a person is an actual disciple of Christ is whether or not they have an ongoing, consistent dialogue going on with Jesus through every situation, every circumstance, in every moment of their life. That is a real indication of discipleship. Not whether or not you can carve out 1 hour of your week and come join someone in a building somewhere and spend an hour and walk out and pat yourself on the back and say, I must be a disciple because I went to prayer meeting and there were only three of us, and so I must be one of the disciples. In fact, I must be one of the disciples that Jesus loved most because I came to the prayer meeting. No, well, do you have an ongoing, consistent, frequently reoccurring conversation with Jesus? That's an indication of real discipleship. So I just have to ask you, how consistent are you in your prayer life? Do you catch yourself talking to our rabbi on an ongoing matter? How many hours of each day goes by where we forget to even talk to this one that we say we're a disciple of? How many moments, minutes, seconds do we go by? Are there 24-hour periods are there 7 days that go by? Or maybe we forget from Sunday to Sunday and we don't have this ongoing conversation with Jesus. Simply put, disciples pray. That is the standard. Disciples pray. We talk about the fact that that the sheep know the shepherd's voice, but I want to flip the script a little bit this morning. Maybe I need to ask this question. Does the shepherd recognize your voice? You know what? I've got some people in my life. I know now we cheat because we all have caller ID on our cell phones, but before then, this is going to be odd to y'all, but when there was this thing attached to the phone that you couldn't walk away from it. We put extra long ones on it. It was called a cord, and the phone would ring, and there was no screen. In fact, you had to do this to dial it. I know that's kind of weird, but so I just dated myself. So I can I experienced that, and there's no caller ID, but there are people in my life that I don't need caller ID for. We have consistently and frequently talked so often that I can pick up the phone with no caller ID, and I recognize their voice. I know who they are. I know that they're reaching out to me. And so my question this morning is you shouldn't have, Jesus shouldn't need caller ID with you. So when you go into prayer, some of us, it's been so long that we say, Dear Lord, and he goes, who is this? I don't even know who this is. Could you? I don't have your number in my phone book. Send him a text. Could you see, who is this? I'm not sure who this is. I don't want to be rude or anything, but I haven't heard from you. And so disciples have consistent prayer going on, frequent, reoccurring dialogue with Jesus. I'm not interested in how many people do or don't show up at a prayer meeting. What I want to know is, are you having prayer meeting in your car? Are you having prayer meeting at work? Are you having prayer meeting as you're playing a game? Are you having prayer meeting as you go through the drive-thru? Are you having a consistent, ongoing conversation with him? Second, I think the second kind of prayer that produces results is the disciples pray persistently. Not only do disciples pray consistently, they also pray persistently. And you say, well, there's a lot of similarities between consistency and persistency. I get it. But there's a difference too. Persistent prayer is something that disciples must develop, because I'm convinced of this. You will never have a consistent prayer life if you don't learn to have a persistent prayer life. That was good. I don't care. You don't have to amen me. I know it was good. Thank you, Mike. I had one good amen out of that. That was good, because I'm just convinced that you will never truly develop consistency, ongoing, daily, reoccurring dialogue if you first don't develop a persistent prayer life. See, persistence is an acquired skill. You have to learn to persevere. You have to learn to endure. You have to learn to hang on. You have to learn to strain and struggle, and that develops strength in our prayer life. You have to learn. Why is perseverance so necessary in our prayer life? Because I just needed to tell you, I just came along to tell you this morning that at some moment in your prayer life, there's going to come this day. There's going to come a circumstance that you're going to face. There's going to come a trial that you continue to face over and over again. And you're going to need persistency, because you will have this moment. You will have to reach this place where you look at God and you say, you know what? I believe who you are. Even when who you are hasn't brought or produced the results that I want to see. That's how we know we're persistent in our prayer life, because a lot of us pray, and when we don't see what we want to see, we throw in the towel. And then that impacts our consistency. So one man said this, I think he's right. I think he said that God works through persevering prayer to do several things. First, he says this. He says, through persevering prayer, God purifies our desires. Because sometimes we may want the right thing for the wrong reasons. Okay, this is good stuff. I didn't even write this. It's still good. He says persevering prayer is necessary because it prepares us for his answer. Because a lot of times a premature answer might cause us to glory more in the gift than in the giver. If he gives us what we ask for too soon, we'll just forget about him altogether. He says that we need to develop persistency because it develops our character and our life. One of God's greatest priorities in prayer is the work he desires to do in us. And you don't get that through microwave prayers. It's through persistency. I go back again and again. And then fourth, he said, to bless us with a more intimate relationship with God. See, Jesus addresses persistent prayer at least twice in Scripture that I can find. As I begin to think about a persistent prayer life and holding on when all my circumstances don't look right, and hanging on and hanging in, I start thinking, well, what did Jesus say about being persistent? Well, twice. In Luke chapter 11, the disciples come to Jesus and they say, teach us how to pray. And he starts teaching them, you know, the prayer, our Father. Okay, y'all know that one, which we call it the Lord's Prayer. It really wasn't the Lord's Prayer, it was the disciples' prayer. The Lord was teaching the disciples how to pray. And right after he teaches them how to pray, he addresses persistency. I mean, there's not even a hesitation. It's all the same prayer. He gives them the prayer, then he says this. He says, suppose you have a friend and you go to him at midnight and say, friend, lend me loaves of bread. A friend of mine on a journey has come to me and I have no food to offer him. And suppose the one inside answers, don't bother me. The door is already locked and my children and I are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything. He says, I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, yet because of your shameless audacity, he will surely give up and give you as much as you. He teaches us how to pray, and then he says, there are going to be times in prayer where you are going to have to just hang on and ask again. He comes back in Luke chapter 18. He does it again. He says, then Jesus told his disciples, and have you ever stopped to ask why he told his disciples parables? Why? Well, in this one, he tells us. He says, then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. He said, in a certain town there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared what people thought, and there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with the plea, grant me justice against my adversary. For some time he refused, but finally he said to himself, even though I don't fear God or care what people think, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice so that she won't eventually come and attack me. In other words, leave me alone. You've asked me so often that I'm just like, okay, finally, here you go. Jesus is trying to teach us that as disciples, we must learn to persistently pray. It's clear that we've got to grow up to this never give up mentality and approach in prayer. even when everything looks wrong, even when everything's falling apart, even when I've asked and I've asked and I've asked and I'm not seeing anything change, I believe in him so much that I will ask him again. I will be persistent because I know he's a good father, because I know he's faithful, because I know he's trustworthy, because I know he has the provision. Not only does he have provision, he has willingness. He's capable and able, and he's also willing. And so I just keep approaching him. See, I wonder if too many of us give up in prayer, and by doing so, this is whether we mean to or not, because a lot of us pray like this. We'll pray, and when we don't see results instantly, we give up. And in doing so, whether we mean to or not, we are literally saying, God, I've given up on you. I have given up on my faith in you. I have given up on my trust in you. I've given up on the belief that you can do anything about this. And so since I've prayed like twice, God, and it's still nothing's changed, like I've asked you twice. Come on, I've had to repeat myself at least twice. So now because you didn't come through, I'll find a different way. Anybody else ever got themselves in trouble doing that? I just want to see. See, Spurgeon said it like this. He says, if you will give him no rest, he will give you all the rest you need. Another minister by the name of Alexander White said this. He says, if you find your life of prayer to be always so short and so easy and so spiritual as to be without cost and strain and sweat to you, you may depend on it. You have not yet begun to pray. I am concerned that in our microwave lifestyle that we have been robbed of the ability to slow cook in prayer. In old circles, I still remember as a kid hearing people talk about this. I'm going to say this term, and some of y'all are going to look at me like you don't even have a clue what I'm talking about. We learned how to tarry in prayer. We learned to tarry. What does that mean? It means to wait. It means to hang on. It means to just keep pressing in. It means just, we used to use this one. This one always struck me as odd, but we used it anyway. We talked about praying through. I always wanted to say praying through what? And then I grew up and realized you got to pray through some stuff, right? Praying through my own desires, praying through my own wants, praying through. I got to learn to pray through persistency in prayer, not giving up, hanging. Let me say it like this. I'm challenging you to become tough in prayer. That's a different way to put it. I want you to be such a disciple that you learn to be tough in prayer. So when everything around me says, give up, quit, nothing's going to change, it's always going to be like this, you've asked before, no results, you're tough enough to go back and say, I haven't seen the change yet, but I still trust you. See, I went back and I started thinking about this. You do realize that every one of the disciples in Jewish system, because this is foreign to us, but in the Jewish system, every disciple had gone to school. When we think of school, we think of like Bridge Creek High School. All right, we think of like Norman Middle School. We think of UConn Elementary School. That's the kind of school we think of. That's not how they went to school. They went to school at church. Every local synagogue was their schoolhouse. And the Bible, the Torah, was their textbook. Can I just tell you already that because the disciples had gone, every one of them had gone to the synagogue to study. It was mandated. They left their father's house, they went to the synagogue, and they studied Scripture. Can I assure you this? They had also been taught and instructed on how to pray. You know how I know? Because I've been to Israel and I watched little 4 and 5 year old boys at the Wailing Wall sitting there, rocking back and forth, praying the Scripture. They're being taught in the synagogue every day how to pray, how to pray, how to pray. They pray the Scriptures, they pray the Scriptures, they pray the Scriptures. So I have no trouble believing. It's not a logical leap. It's an assured fact that the disciples had been taught how to pray. So why would they ask Jesus how to pray? If they'd already been taught how to pray, why would they come to Jesus and say, Rabbi, teach us how to pray? I think I've got the answer. I think it's because they saw the impact of his prayers. And I think they saw the power of his prayers. And I think they saw the results of his prayers. And I think while they watched that taking place in Jesus' life, and they watched the consistency of Jesus' prayer life, and they certainly watched the persistency of Jesus' prayer life, because how many of you prayed until you started sweating blood? I think they watched it, and all of a sudden they saw the impact and the results of Jesus' prayer life, and they went, we want that. Right? I see you raising people from the dead. I see you taking bread and praying over it, and it like multiplies. Teach me that. I see you doing some crazy stuff, Jesus. Teach me how you pray, because I want. Right? So this is my question then. When's the last time somebody asked you to teach them? Maybe people don't ask us to teach them how to pray because they don't see the consistency and the persistency in our prayer life to the point that it is producing results, and so they don't want to learn how we pray because they don't. I'm just trying to convince you this morning that the prayer life that attracts me most is not an eloquent prayer life. It's not a flamboyant prayer life. It's not even necessarily, it could be, but it's not necessarily even a loud prayer life. It is people that have learned to pray consistently, that have an ongoing dialogue with Jesus to the point that Jesus recognizes their voice and they recognize Jesus' voice. It's people that have been persistent, who've gone through trial and heartbreak and tragedy, but they still keep calling on Jesus and they keep speaking to Jesus and they keep trusting Jesus. Those are the people whose prayer life I'm attracted to, and I want to be attracted to your prayer life. See, why is it that we want to go learn how preachers pray? Why is it that it's preachers that write books on prayer? Why is it that we promote preachers' prayer life as if preachers have the monopoly on prayer life? Listen, I want us as a congregation, just the average Joe Blow, just somebody that's just attending church, we think, I want every one of us to develop such a consistent and a persistent prayer life that you could write the book. And that people would approach you and say, hey, there's something different about you. When you're going through difficult times, it never seems to affect you. You just continue to believe and continue to hold on. That will take place when you become consistent and persistent. I've discovered that the people that always want the microphone to pray may not have the most effective prayer life. It's usually the ones that resist the microphone and say, I don't want to pray in front of anybody. But Jesus hears their voice. I want to challenge you this morning to simply become more consistent, moment by moment, day by day, minute by minute. Put it in your phone if you've got to remind you that there is a rabbi that needs to hear your voice. I just want to challenge you this morning that if you've been holding on and you've been trying to be tough and it seems like nothing's changing and it feels like you're praying and the prayers are bouncing off the ceiling back at you, can I just tell you, just keep praying. I want to encourage you this morning, don't give up. Don't quit. Don't throw in the towel. His track record is sure. Just keep pressing in. Become like the widow woman. Knock on the door again. Become like the neighbor. Go bang on the door and pray audacious prayers and say, God, please, I've asked. I know I've asked, but I'm asking again. I'm asking again. And maybe you've just started this relationship with this rabbi by the name of Jesus. I want to encourage you to start talking to him daily and start talking to him about what matters in your life and let him learn your voice. So that you'll hear his. Will you stand with me this morning? Simply put, disciples pray. Disciples pray. If we are going to be fully devoted followers of Christ, then we must develop a prayer life. I'm not asking you if you can pray an hour. I'm not going to call you in here on an off night and start the timer and say, well, if you don't hit the 20-minute mark, you must not be a disciple. And while you lay on your face somewhere here in the building, you fall asleep because you're exhausted. But you made the 20-minute mark, so you're a disciple. No, what I'm challenging you to do is to talk to Jesus so often and so frequently and so persistently that when there's a need in the body, they don't have to come to the preacher. They can come to you and say, would you pray for me? Because they've watched you and they've seen things change. And they've seen you go through hard times. They've seen you hold on. And they know that if you talk to him, he'll hear you. Do you have anybody in your life right now that you can go to that you know that when they speak to Jesus, Jesus hears them? I have somebody. I've got several somebodies. I've got my wife. I've got my dad and mom. And I got some really close friends that I know if I say, hey, will you pray? They don't have to grab a microphone and pray eloquently. I know that their prayers are effective. Do you have anybody? Are you somebody to anybody that they can trust you? Father, this morning, this is my prayer, my simple prayer. I pray that you would teach us to pray consistently and persistently. And I'm going to switch the order, Lord, real quick. I just pray that over some folks in this room today that feel like giving up. They've asked and they haven't seen anything change. They've asked and it's been a tough time and it's like they're not even sure that you hear. If that's you, would you just raise a hand? Nobody's going to look around. I'm not even going to ask anybody to lay hands on you. If that's you, just raise your hand. I've asked and it doesn't seem like anything's changing. And sometimes I feel like giving up. My hand's up. You don't have to look around. My hand is up. Father, you see our hands, but more importantly, you see our hearts. There are many of us in this room that we've been asking. And now it feels like it's time to throw in the towel. I pray that right now that you would burn in a new determination, burn in new courage, burn in new strength to us right now, I pray, in Jesus' name. I pray that right now you would strengthen us, help us to sustain us, help us to be persistent. If we thought there was somebody else that could do what you could do, we might go somewhere else, but we're convinced of this. You're God. You've got all power. You've got all authority. You've got all ability. You've got all the provision. You've got all the healing. You've got all the restoration that we need. So, Father, we just continue to persist in you. We persist. We persist. We refuse. We dig in. We get tough. We approach you again. We approach you again. And we approach you again. And we approach you again. And we'll approach you again. And we approach you again. And we'll ask again. And we'll ask again, and we'll ask again until we see your will accomplished in our life. So, Father, I pray in Jesus' name right now that you would help us to become persistent in our prayer life. And then, Father, secondly, I pray that as disciples, we would become very consistent in a prayer life. We wouldn't wait on a church door to be open to pray. I pray that we would find ourselves talking to you on a regular basis. First thing in the morning when we wake up, I pray that the dialogue would start. And I pray that it would be frequently reoccurring all day long until it's time for bed. And the last thing that goes through our mind is, Father, I've enjoyed the conversation today. I'm glad I have unlimited minutes. I can approach you boldly and know that you're listening and that you're speaking. And so, Father, I pray this morning right now that you would enable us to be more consistent in our prayer life. I ask you to do this to the place that people will come and ask us to teach them how to pray. I pray that you would accomplish that in Jesus' name. And everybody that's willing to pray more consistently and persistently, would you say amen this morning? Now, would you touch your neighbor right now and say, I need you to learn how to pray, to teach me how to pray. One of those two, learn or teach, doesn't matter, one of the two.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor, for that word. Can we just thank our pastor real quick? Yeah. He's a great man. I just want to thank you guys for coming this morning. If it's your first time, inside of your brochure packet thingy, whatever this thing is, inside of there we have a connection area. If you'll fill that out and give it to Pastor Steve, he has a treat for you in the back. But if it is your second time, we also want you to go ahead and swing by to Pastor Steve, say hello. He also has a gift for you. So if it's your first time, fill out the communication card, bring it to Pastor Steve. If it's your second time, then go see Pastor Steve. Both of those include a gift. Isn't that exciting? Gifts are always exciting. So as we prepare our morning tithes and offering, I was reading a little bit, and I found an interesting verse in Exodus chapter 35, and I'm just going to read it. It says, "Then all the congregation of the people of Israel departed from the presence of Moses, and they came, everyone whose heart stirred him, and everyone whose spirit moved him, and they brought the Lord's contribution to be used for the tents of meeting." This story tells about how your contribution goes to the tents of meeting. And it's simple. Let me see if I can grab this thing. That's pretty simple, huh? Give. Because we need you guys to give, not only for your sake. The Bible talks about being blessed whenever we give. More blessed to give than to receive, right? We know that scripture. But I would encourage you guys to give, not only for your sake, but also for this body's sake. Is that selfish to ask? No, probably not. Tari's with me. I don't know. I don't know if anybody else is with me. But check out our next sermon series.
Good morning. Let's take a look at what's happening at Passion Church this week. If you are new to Passion, then you are invited to our VIP meal next Sunday after second service. This is a short and informal meeting for you to get to know us and for us to get to know you. I've also heard there's a free gift. Ignite Youth, don't miss Rocktober on Wednesday, October 31st at 6:30 p.m. Invite some friends and get ready to bash all kinds of stuff. In November, we begin a new sermon series. Take a look.
Coming live with Rodney. What is the number one thing in life that you put your trust in?
Money.
Money?
The most trust in myself.
Why yourself?
Because if I can't trust myself, who else can I trust?
That's a good point.
If you get it, you can have whatever you need, like go to the doctor like I'm doing right now. So that's why.
So the question we're asking everybody is, what is the number one thing in life you put trust in?
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ?
That's
a good answer. Do you trust me?
I just met you.
Okay, so no, but Jesus Christ is a great answer.
Amen. Stand with me this morning. On your way out, you're going to get a card. This is for you to be able to invite people. People need to know this message that we trust in the Lord and in the Lord alone. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for being with us. We thank you for just showering us with your love. And we also thank you for the word that was brought forth. We pray that it would fall on good soil in our hearts. And we pray that we would take that word and live it out. We love you, Lord. We give you all the praise in your precious name. Amen. 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 Have a good week.